with me today are Kathy Daugherty, Executive Director, and Heather Andrews, Nurturing Coordinator and Resource Specialist of the Queen Anne County Department of Social Services. Welcome, ladies.
Thank you.
What can you tell me about, you know, what constitutes homelessness other than the fact that someone doesn't have a place to live? I mean, can you fill me in a little bit more on what that problem is in Queen Anne County?
Homelessness is an individual that lacks a regular, adequate, fixed nighttime residence. And, you know, even those, we're going to bring up the word couch surfers pretty early with this, but couch surfers in this area are very prevalent. And those are one the individuals and families that kind of move from place to place, families and friends. They're staying on couches, they're staying here and there. But again, they fit that HUD definition of no regularly fixed nighttime residence.
I've heard that term before, but honestly, I didn't know what it meant. You know, okay, it makes sense now, you know.
We never heard it either till a couple years ago.
Okay.
As we got educated about the problem, especially the problem in this county, people tend to believe that this is a wealthy county and these problems don't exist. But what we find in our day-to-day work is that the problem is increasing. We've seen the numbers of people coming in asking for assistance in housing on the rise. And then Heather specializes in this particular subject area, and she specializes in talking to these people that come in with housing issues. And we are finding it's more than we thought.
Is there a misconception about the homelessness in here in Queen Anne County? I mean, you mentioned, you know, up till, well, at least from my standpoint, up until very recently, I really wasn't even aware there was a problem.
Well, a couple years ago, our Haven Ministries opened up a shelter that's only a cold weather shelter, so that in the wintertime, the homeless could have a place to go and be warm at nighttime and also receive a hot meal. And I think before that, there was no homeless shelter in the county. So I think at that point that it was there but not addressed. And then once the cold weather shelter became in existence, and it was staffed by volunteers, I believe most of it is, they are now trying to build a full-time shelter in the county. But it'll be a while. But I think before that, it wasn't recognized. But now that it is recognized, we have to move forward and accept the fact and provide the right services.
Again, I think the misconception is that it's a Baltimore City thing. It's
right.
A big city thing. And it's going to be the person that's on the street and, you know, underneath the bridge or in their car, which is part of that definition. But again, since HUD changed that definition to include those that are, you know, again, going back to that word, couch surfers, to include those as well as those that are recently released from incarceration, and just, again, just lacks that regular fixed nighttime residence. And again, I think that's just that misconception.
And it involves more families with children than, obviously, people thought before, too. I think people think of homeless as the man who drinks too much and doesn't have a place to go to, like you said, under the bridge. But instead,
right.
We're seeing families. And perhaps they, you know, came from another state to be up here closer to their family. And when they got there, the job that was promised them isn't here. They can't afford the housing here. It's a very high housing cost in this county. That's why a lot of people live in other counties and maybe work here, because the housing here is rather high, the cost. But, you know, when you're talking about, you know, just not just single, you know, men, it's their families that are homeless as well, children.
Do you have any hard numbers on how many people are in this situation that are homeless or at risk of being homeless in the county?
Okay. I can speak for the Department of Social Services. What we're actually doing is anyone that comes in to the front reception and identifies themselves as homeless, they go and see a services intake worker, which if I'm there, then I've been sitting down with the individual or the family, and then I keep track of those that have come in. And I found within almost a year, I began July the 29th last year, 2013, approximately 115 families. And I say families could be individuals, single moms with children, it could be a couple, it could be a boyfriend, a girlfriend, and it's 183 total, 51 male adults average age of 38, 77 female adults, average age of 36, 26 male children, 22 female children, and their average age is between 7 and 8 years old.
Wow.
So it's really has been outstanding. You know, we take a look, again, and they say they come in and say that they're homeless. And again, I try to sit down with them. We take a look at their resources, what they have, what resources we have to provide. We just have like the housing shelter lists. We have the food pantry lists, financial assistance. We take one of my PQI teams, which is the performance quality improvement team. we wanted to say it was a survey, but now we're calling it more of an assessment tool. So we wanted to take that demographic information. So I'm getting some of that together. But we also listed all the needs and resources. And the client will check off. And there are certain things I can go on in there and I can say, okay, they checked off that they're a veteran. Well, I know there are services for veterans. I'm going to get you contacted with those. I see that you need a birth certificate or a state ID. Well, through Midshore Mental Health, which Deneen Beasley will be here later, she will be able to provide more for regional data for you. But they have a grant for a homeless ID program. And we just do the application, and within a couple weeks they can go to the MVA or the health department and get their certificate or state.
Speaking of the application, what's the process that a homeless person would have to go through to come to social service? Do they physically have to come? Can they call? Can they email? I mean, I doubt if they're homeless, they probably don't have access to email.
Right. But people will call and say they need help, and we tell them they need to come in person so that we can really work out a plan with them to look at what their problem is and what kind of resources we can apply. So we're open, Monday through Friday, except for weekends and holidays. We're there 8 o'clock to 4:30, and they can just walk in. They don't have to have an appointment or anything. They're, like Heather said, the receptionist is there as soon as you come in. And
not to interrupt you, but no, where are you located at?
We're located 125 Comet Drive in Centerville. It's beside the fitness place in Centerville, so most people know how to get there. And, there's no parking issues or anything like that in small town. And there we have a social worker who is on call throughout the entire day, so that there's always going to be somebody available. They've made their time available on their calendar so that when they walk in, they can see somebody within minutes. They don't have to give their story to the receptionist. They just need to say, I need to speak with somebody about housing.
I would think a lot of them would be embarrassed,
right.
And so that's great that a social worker would be available to talk to them.
Right. And, there's just different things that we can do. And I think, but back to the numbers for a second, one of the things that through the Midshore Mental Health Group, they have their grants and they calculate homeless in a different way. And one of the things that they do is they do a point in time survey, which occurs in January. And they do a day where they try to count how many people today are homeless to see what representation that is for the full year. And that number has come down very much lower than what we're counting. The reality we have always known was that the true number was higher than that, but it's a very difficult number to come up with because of the pride issue, or people don't know where to go for help, or they keep thinking that they're going to figure it out. The answer
sure.
is down the next door. The next day is going to be their answer, and then it's another day of homelessness. So we try to help anyone who comes in the door to put that aside and realize that they have needs. They're people. We're people. We're basically all just a few paychecks away from being in a situation, of being homeless. If you're supposed to have all of this income saved up in case of an emergency, but how many people really have that? I don't.
It
could happen to anybody, and that's our vision, is that anybody who walks in could be any one of us or anyone in our own family. So we want to treat them the same way we would want to be treated, because it could be us.
A couple of terms that have come up in having discussions about this. One is the living wage. Can you explain what that is? And also the working poor.
Living wage is a wage that you make where you can live comfortably, but minimum wage is not is a living wage. That's the working poor. The working poor is someone that's making minimal amount, the minimum wage, and cannot sustain themselves.
So a number of these people then are working. They're just
Many
not
of
making
them are.
Sufficient
yes.
income to be able to
afford
have
housing.
A permanent home.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's the home. It's, you know, if you go to a new home, you have to have security deposit, which is usually pretty hefty. And, you know, you can't be late on your rent or you get thrown out and then you lose everything. And then just, you know, the utilities, it all adds up to a good amount of money. And the people that are working at, you know, a fast food restaurant and they're making minimum wage, whatever, that and they got children, it's really hard to make it.
And then have one thing occur. Your car breaks mm-hmm. down, you're hospitalized, and then you're, you know, mm-hmm. really into
your child's
into that.
Sick and you sure. have to miss work mm-hmm. to take care of your child, things like that.
What about senior citizens? Do you have special services for them? And I think you also mentioned disabled people. Can you expand on that a little bit?
For senior citizens, I know I call on one of my colleagues. She's an adult services worker. And I will, you know, ask her as well for other resources. There's, I would say, just referring them to the Department of Aging mm-hmm. is one big, you know, resource for them.
We have a state program called Social Services to Adults, so that if there's an adult over the age of 18 who cannot meet their minimum standards of care for themselves, then they are eligible to receive services. You know, they can't figure out how to feed themselves or take care of their health issues, and so that their lives are in danger. We don't want that to happen, and there is a state program for that. So we do have workers that can, social workers who can go and talk with them. Now, that might not be the homeless situation, but they may have inadequate housing, so that, you know, they can't get hot running water, or you know, maybe they've gotten behind in the cleanliness of their home because of handicapping situations, or just their age has disabled them. But we have social workers and aides that could go in the home and help them, because we want them to be able to be in their own home as long as possible.
Sure.
And we work in conjunction with the Department of Aging, because they have their programs, and then they know what our programs are too, so we work together, because the health department as well will do evaluations of the elderly to find out what kind of services they may qualify for that they don't know about. We work very close with our partners around the seniors.
Mm-hmm. I understand that you're directly involved with the Make a Difference Day. Can you tell us a little bit more about what that will be? And
well, like,
you know,
I say, we when we found out that the numbers were higher, we were also inspired by many of the other jurisdictions in the state that have done a homeless day event, and that was very successful. So we were able to get some backing from the Department of Human Resources, the state office that's over us, and we've put together a working committee to begin pull together the information and what we needed to do. So after that first committee, it was just a startup, then we were able to combine with the Housing and Community Services, Candace Darling, and I asked her at a meeting one day, how about you become the co-chair, and then Heather would be the other co-chair of the event, and it was a marriage made in heaven, and the two of
well,
them are working really good.
You're good at delegating, really good. Then, aren't
you? I am, that's my job. But I'm as involved in it as time allows, and I will certainly be there that day, and we can use some more volunteers to help us that day. We're going to have the names of volunteers and get them trained ahead of time, because we want people to have navigators, so when they get there that day, they just don't walk into an open room and not know where to start. They're going to be assigned somebody to walk through the system with them,
exactly.
And make sure
That's
that they
great.
Get all of the resources that they need.
Well, how and can then, people in the community, people like myself, how can we get involved to help you? Can we call, email,
contact,
how do we get in touch?
Contact Heather.
I would say contact Heather or Candace Darling. And
our phone number, 410-758-8000, and ask for Heather Andrews, or email heather.andrews@maryland.gov.
Very good.
That's
you want to repeat
account.
That just so
sure.
People have a chance to grab a pencil and write it down?
Yes, 410-758-8000. Unless you want to give your direct, but somebody will answer all the time at 8000, and they can just ask to be connected to Heather Andrews. And email would be heather.andrews@maryland.gov.
Very good.
And Candace would be, is she C. Darling?
It's C. Darling at QAC.org.
Okay,
very good. And we are accepting cash donations, too. We have a fund started to help with the cost of that day because we're going to have vendors there that will be providing services on site, and some of that will be free. They're all free to the customers, but
right.
You know, we might have some fees associated with some of that, putting the day together. So we have started a fund aside just for this event.
Oh, that's great. Well, look, I want to thank both of you so much for coming in and explaining to us what this is all about. And thank you for your work.
Thank you.
Thank you.